Okay, I sure hope so. I sure hope so. That is the worship of the living God that brought you here today. And not a tradition, not necessarily just a custom or a ritual, but rather because you genuinely believe he deserves this sacrifice on your part. And thank you. Thank you for being here, Manna Bible Baptist Church. We so appreciate, again, the things that God is doing in this church. This week, this past week, we spent 5 days in prayer as what we call corporate prayer. And corporate prayer is where the Spirit of God calls his people together to assemble together. And in fact, in the nation of Israel, 3 times the men of Israel were called out of their homes, called out from their normal routine, set aside time. God asked them, commanded them, in fact, to meet him 3 times. He asked the men of Israel to meet him 3 times a year around the festivals. And we thought that would be so necessary for us if we as a church would begin to take more seriously the virtue of prayer and what that would look like. We're not sure entirely, but what we did, we set aside an entire week for prayer so that the body might come together and pray together. I have some more things to say about that as we get into our message, but I'm so glad that a number of saints came out, not the entire body, which is unfortunate, but, you know, God knows, and God, whatever God is doing, we just accept the process, and it takes a little while for us to get there, but nevertheless, we're trusting God to work his work in us. But even so, I am so grateful for several of the saints who were out this week. And I'm just wondering, I'd like to maybe just take a few minutes. I'd love for you to hear from them about their sense of what God was doing in their lives through corporate prayer. Now, I know we pray at home, and that's good. That's to be commended. We expect that. We want that. But God does great things through the corporate body, and we're going to get into that, but I want to share. I want a couple to share, and I think one, Blanche, she indicated that she'd love to share some thoughts about what God did in her life. And here it is.
This one? Testing.
There it is. Uh-huh.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I just want to say it was a blessing for me, personally, myself, to come out and press my way for prayer, corporate prayer. It is truly needed, especially now in these days that we are living in. We all need to be praying together. It is so important because just like in the Word, when they all came and prayed together, what it does, it changes. It changes in ways that we don't even see it changing. But I just thank the Lord for the intimacy that we get with him when we come and pray together. And when we pray together, we may not know what's going on with other people, but when we hear them pray, then we can go to that person and we can pray for them and let them know we mean it. It's genuine. It's not phony. It's not fake. But I just thank the Lord for dealing with me, I'm talking about me. I don't know about nobody else. I'm talking about me with what I need to do in my life as far as prayer. And I thank the Lord that I do have a prayer partner. And I pray on Tuesday mornings with the women's Bible study. But we need corporate prayer. We need it, especially now.
God bless you, Blanche. Thank you. Amen.
Good morning, saints.
Amen. God bless you, Loretta.
It was really a treat to come out to fellowship with the saints. We showed a lot of love for the Lord and for each other. Mm-hmm. And it was truly a blessing. And I hope that we get to do it more often, and I hope more people will come out and experience the fellowship that we had. We encourage one another. We lift each other up in prayer. There were beautiful testimonies. It was just praise, praise, praise. So I invite you next time we have this occasion, please come out and enjoy it. It will help you to grow, because we still need to be growing in the Lord every day. We can't grow enough. So next time, I expect to see you, and you expect to see me.
Amen. Linnea, why don't you share? No, they're done. Linnea.
Good morning. I only got a chance to go one time, but I came on Friday, and it was such a blessing. I was led to come on Friday because of my personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He deals with me, like Sister Blanche says, and when he convicts me, I have to obey and I have to listen, even with my son next to me. Coming there, fellowshipping and praying, I felt his presence there immediately when I came in. And in my prayer, I just wanted to thank him for getting me through my journey of unemployment, a job, just letting me know he's my provider. I've been through a lot, but I'm here. My church family, they loved me. And I wanted to be here on Friday to fellowship with them and to confess my sins, because I want to be closer and closer to Jesus, and I want to just give him all of me. So in my prayer, I sang a song through my prayer, and Pastor asked me to sing it again, so I'm going to sing it. Give me you, everything else can wait. Give me you, I hope I'm not too late. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Give me you. Everything else must wait. Give me you. I hope I'm not too late. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Give me you, everything else must wait. Give me you, I hope I'm not too late. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. 'Cause it's me, oh Lord, I'm on my knees, crying out to you. Oh, it's me, oh Lord, I'm on my knees, crying out to you, Lord. Give me you, everything must wait. Give me you, I hope I'm not too late. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you.
Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Oh, 'cause it's me, oh Lord. I'm on my knees crying out to you, Lord. It's me, oh Lord. I'm on my knees crying out to you. Give me you. Everything else can wait. It can wait. Give me you. I hope I'm not too late. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you. Lord, give me you.
Father, once again, thanking you for your presence, and we thank you for the expressions, the thoughts, the words, the songs. Thank you for Linnea expressing on our behalf, for us, in our stead, words of desperation. We need you. Everything else must wait. Forgive us, Father, for putting so many things before you, making you wait. Cleanse us from our selfish thinking about ourselves. Help us now, even in our understanding of your word, to hear your voice. And I pray, Father, that you would be glorified. Do your work in our spirits, in our minds. For some of us, Lord, it might mean turning over the table in the temple and driving out other spirits. You said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. For some, it might be sacrificing Isaac, the willingness to put to death things that separate us from you. For others, we need King Uzziah to die before we see the Lord. I just pray, Father, whatever it takes, and I mean it with all my heart, Father, that whatever it takes to awaken your people, we're yours. Move upon us, Spirit of God. Break up the fallow ground. Soften hearts for your Spirit. Change the stiff necks. Give us a sense of submission to the will of God first, to the priority of seeking Jesus first. Save us from ourselves. I pray it's not too late. Thank you so much for the tremendous sacrifice you paid, Lord, to save us. And yes, Lord, you deserve it. We own you today. We so adore you and want to hear from you, from your precious word. Speak, I pray, and be glorified, we ask in Jesus' name. In Revelation 2, Jesus says, I know your works. He's talking to the Ephesus church, the church at Ephesus, and he says, I know your works. I know your labor. I know your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles, and they are not, and you have found them to be liars. And you have persevered, and you have patience, and you have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. Verse 4 of chapter 2, the letter called Revelation of Jesus Christ. In verse 4, it says, nevertheless, Jesus says, nevertheless, he speaks to the church of Ephesus, nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, God help us to hear. Let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Last year, we started a series in this book, in this letter, and we were asked the question, what does it take to get back? Because Jesus said to remember from where you have fallen. In other words, we've departed from giving Jesus the priority. He says we've left him as first love. He should have first place in our lives. And we sang it, we say it, often we don't do it. He says, you've left your first love. How do we get that back? How do we get back on track with the Lord? And it is possible to go through the routines of going to church. It's possible to go through the routines of preaching, singing. It's possible to go through the routine of doing whatever we do as deacons, as ushers, as choir members. It's possible to do the routine without having a sense of authentic and genuine devotion and love for Jesus Christ. Amen. We can be notorious in our hypocrisy, saying one thing and hiding our heart. Jesus says, I want you to remember from where, that's fall, that's a fall, that's a decline. When we don't love him with the priority, it's decline. Stated last week that we're either getting closer or we're moving further away. There is no middle ground. So we're either in decline in our love and devotion, or we're growing in our love. Well, Jesus says, I want you to remember from where you have fallen. I want you to repent. That is, change your mind. You need to change your mind, change your direction. You're going in the wrong direction. I want you to repent. Repent means make a U-turn. I remember this happens to me often with Siri, the GPS. I know my way, you know, and sometimes I could be on a trip and I know my way out of Baltimore. Right? In fact, you could probably put me any place in Baltimore and I can find my way back home. Just so familiar with Baltimore. But once you know, we get on the road and trying to find Pennsylvania, New York, or whatever, that's where the GPS, well, one time I turned Siri on too soon, and she's trying to take me in a way that's not the way I go. And so I'm turning, making left, making right, and finally I just said, no, shut up, Siri, I know. And then I turned it back on once I got out of town. But in the meantime, while I had it on, she's rerouting me, finally, one time when I did get a bit turned around, I listened to Siri. I assumed I knew where I was, you know, because I know Baltimore, right? We can be so familiar with our own sense of what we are, what we know, and really miss the direction of what God is doing, where God is taking us. Well, repentance is reorienting our GPS for God, toward God, to change our mind about the direction we're going in. It means listening and following the Spirit of God. He says, remember, repent, and redo the first works. What are those priority? What are those first works? Last year we started and we're looking at the first thing we do in order to get back on track with Jesus Christ is it first takes seeking him. You can't love Jesus if you're not seeking him. Seeking Jesus, you can't do that in sitting still. It takes some type of movement and activity in the direction of in pursuit of Jesus. So it's seeking him. It is sacrificing for Jesus. You can't love him if it doesn't cost you. And there is no love for God. There is no cheaper version. There is no discount in the love for Jesus Christ. There is no markdown. It requires sacrifice on our part to be genuine and authentic in our love for Jesus. And then we came upon also the idea, not just seeking, not just sacrificing, but also suffering. To love him, to seek him, to know him deeply is to suffer with him. And it's in this suffering that we take on, as it were, we're willing to take on, as the Apostle Paul said in Philippians 3, that I may know him. I want to know him in the fellowship of his suffering. That's how we deepen our experience with him. That is, we share in the gospel, the suffering of the gospel. We become partakers of the gospel. We share the gospel, and sometimes in sharing the gospel, you become a victim of ridicule. You will lose your friends. Well, that's suffering for Jesus. Some of us would rather have our friends rather than suffer for Jesus. Well, to love him, it requires seeking him, sacrificing. It requires, yes, suffering for Jesus. And in this suffering, it also leads us to this place of serving the Lord, serving, and being satisfied with him. How do I serve him out of satisfaction and do it with a sense of genuineness? Well, the idea of being satisfied with Jesus means that we need to be going through a process of spiritual formation, development, spiritual development. That's what grows us. That's what makes us stronger believers, so that we're not impotent in our walk with the Lord. We want to be vibrant and alive for Jesus Christ. What does it take? What does it take to get us there? When Jesus says to the Ephesus church, you've left your first love. I suspect too that they were in decline in their spiritual formation. They weren't being formed. In fact, look with me at this passage in Galatians chapter 4. This is just a tidbit of what some of the things I want to share this morning. And I'm not trying not to keep you long, but I do want to do what the Lord said to do. In fact, you all hired me to do this, didn't you? Amen. Mm-hmm. Don't laugh. Yeah, I hear it. But you hired me to do this. So, but you know what I've discovered? I discovered this, and it's okay. God has worked it in my heart. It's okay, because this is just part of par for the course. It's just part of what happens with leadership. But I've discovered that in pastoring, some people don't want a pastor, they want just a preacher. They hire you, just preach to me on Sunday. I just want to hear, and then I'll go home and do what I want to do. See, some churches, that's all they want is just a preacher. But they don't want a pastor. See, a pastor, in fact, the scripture says describes the pastor as a shepherd, somebody who will lead you and guide you to a place where you can be fed spiritually with the intention of what? Growth and formation into the image of Jesus Christ. You hired me. I understood that you hired me to be your pastor and not just a preacher. So I want to pastor you. I want to shepherd you. My heart, I shared with in through the week of prayer, just my heart, my longing for the body. And you know what? God does that. God gives pastors. He gives us hearts, his heart, his love, his passion for his people. And it becomes, and God knows, it's a burden. I just want you to know. And I'm not, I just want your prayer. That's what I want. But I just want you to know, to be a pastor is to be burdened for the people of God. Burdened by a sense of their lack of spiritual pursuit of God. It burdens me when I don't see the reciprocal response to the teaching of the Word of God. It's a burden. It's a burden to be a leader, to try and shepherd people when sheep, the shepherd's going this way and the sheep are going that way. It's a burden, and it's a burden that God gives his people. And basically, he wants me to know what he feels. He wants the pastor. You know what God did? God took Hosea. God took Hosea, the minor prophet, and here Israel is disobedient, stiff-necked, won't listen to God. And God said, "Look, I need you to go and preach to them. And in order for you to feel, to know, and to preach the word, I want you to know what it feels like for me as God." What did he do? He said, "I want you to marry Gomer. Go get Gomer, that prostitute." And Hosea just marries the prostitute. What does he do? He breaks his heart because she goes after all these other men. And then she brings the children from her adulterous relationship, brings them back to Hosea. When Hosea gets a sense of what God is going through, he was able then to preach the word. But it was only after he married this woman who broke his heart. And God said to Hosea, that's what my people have done. What have they done? They're going after false gods. They're laying down with false gods. They're committing adultery with false. They have put in where I belong. They put other gods there. Now, right away, some of us are going to say, "Well, I would never do that. I would never worship a false god." Well, I'm not so sure that's true. No, we don't carve out of trees and put them up on a grove and go up on a hill and worship some false god. You know what we do? Our false gods now have motors. They're not trees. Our false gods are now clothes and jobs and money and materialism and positions and status and all these symbols have taken the place of God. And spiritual formation is in decline. And yet we miss and here, listen to what God says in Galatians chapter 4, verse 19. And God is speaking through Paul. He says these words, "My little children," listen how tenderly Paul speaks to these precious people of God. He calls them "my little children." The word "children" there are a couple of words there in the New Testament in the Greek. When Paul wrote it, he didn't write it in English. He wrote it in Greek. One of the words for children is the word "paidon." Paidon is this word, what he's using here for "my little children." It's not an adult. It's not a teenager. It's a little child. I've just held my grandson, David III, in my arms, and he's a precious little paidon. He's a toddler. He's just learning to walk. And Paul calls these believers in Galatians, your toddlers, my little toddlers. He says, for whom I labor in birth. He led them to the Lord. I labor in birth again until Christ is formed in you. See, he's thinking of spiritual formation. He wants them to be formed into the image of Christ, that Christ would be formed in them. Paul was burdened for Galatians, the Galatian church. He was burdened for the Corinthian church. He was burdened for the Colossae church, the Ephesus church, the Philippian church. Everywhere he founded a church, he was burdened for them because he wanted them to develop in Jesus Christ. It is impossible for elders and leaders not to be burdened with the people of God, with spiritual formation. Spiritual formation is key to what God wants to do in us and through us. And so what I've termed spiritual formation, I've often used this idea of expanding our capacity for the Lord. Expanding our capacity. Some of us have little thimbles full. I mean, once that thimble gets full, that's enough. That's all we can take of the Lord and the things of God. And sometimes it leads us to not be faithful. Let me just leave it there and let me press on. But spiritual formation is this idea of expanding our capacity. God wants to grow us in our spiritual walk. And so with this idea of growing, I want you to look at this passage in 2 Peter. Look with me at 2 Peter. God wants to expand you this year. I hope and pray that here, we recently started 2017, that you're not where you were last year at the beginning of 2016. Hope and pray that you're pressing, you're moving, you've grown closer to the Lord Jesus in your affection for him and in your pursuit of him. You're doing things that you didn't do before. Now you're doing some things and you're growing, you're expanding your capacity. You can endure. I shared with the prayer group on I forgot what day, but when we met here for prayer those 5 days, I shared with them. I was so grateful to be among the praying of God's people, because I've never in my walk with the Lord, I've never spent 2 hours in prayer until this week. This is the first time I've actually spent 2 hours in prolonged prayer with the Lord. Now, an hour, maybe even an hour and a half, maybe, but it's in, even in that hour, there's interjections and distractions. You know, I'll get up and, okay, okay, I got to make a phone call, and I'll interrupt my prayer time and go make this phone call, and then I'll come back. And so this hour is filled with other stuff, but when the body met together, it gave me the ability to be focused, and for 2 hours, Jesus said to his disciples, he says, look, just before he goes to the cross, he says to Peter, James, and John, he says, look, I want you to turn aside with me. I need you to come and pray with me. As he's feeling the burden of dying on the cross for your sins and mine, it's encroaching in his spirit. And he said, even my soul, I'm burdened in my soul. It was heavy knowing what he was going to go through. And he said, look, guys, I need you to pray with me. What he illustrates in there is that breakthrough in prayer. Now, you can pray by yourself. But what Jesus illustrated, he said, I want you to pray with me. What is that? That's a sense of corporate, because there's strength in prayer. He needed to finish this work, and he needed the support of those who he was closest to. He said, come pray with me.
He goes just a little further and prays. And then he comes back to them, and the Bible says, Jesus said, you couldn't pray with me 1 hour. See, after 1 hour, I can get sleepy, I can get fidgety, I can get distracted. But this week, it was 2 hours. So you know what? I have grown. I'm being spiritually formed. My capacity for God has increased. And now prayer. This week it moved from drudgery. Oh no. 5 days, 2 hours. In fact, I felt the responsibility of being in the afternoon prayer, 12 to 2, and in the evening prayer, 6 to 8. I'm the one who said, let's pray, right? You know, I had to be here. And the drudgery, oh, it dawned on me. Oh, my goodness. And then it was in the sweet moments of Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, Thursday and Friday, that somewhere along the line in those hours, those 2 hours with the people of God, it moved from drudgery to duty. This is what I've got to do this. And it moved from duty to finally delight. Oh God, I love this. And the same was true for others. They said to me, Pastor, we got to do this some more. And I was just blown away by that. But the idea is that spiritual formation, it's God wants to move us from where we are. And if there is such a thing as a gross sins that the church can commit, I think among those gross sins is our apathy. Yes, when we can become so indifferent, so cold and distant to the things of God, it just doesn't matter. That's decline. That's a sign of decline. The doctor told me, Dr. Goldstein at GBMC, he said to me, now, you know, when you go to the doctor and you're not expecting, you know, bad news, it's just a checkup, right? You're just going for a checkup, but you go and you find out that you have cancer. It was stunning. It was stunning. And yet, it was necessary for me to know that. It was necessary for me to understand the state of my physical body. If I was ignorant to the state of my physical body, my life would be shortened. And in fact, he caught it just before the cancer was getting ready to spread beyond the membrane of the prostate gland. Caught it just in time before it spread into the outer regions beyond there and into the bone and into the lymph nodes. He caught it. And it was, in a sense, bad news. But it led to good things. Because it was only in hearing the bad news, the reality of where I am, that I can be awakened to what I need to do and be. If I persisted in my ignorance, thinking everything is fine when it's not, then my life would be shortened. And the quality of life would have been in further decline. But it was only what he did. He was a faithful doctor who examined the diagnostic testing and came to the conclusion, you know, you've got cancer. And he didn't say it in some nice, sweet, you know, Mr. Gaines, you have cancer. No, he was emphatic. You've got cancer. And it's the it was the sense of the way he said it. It gripped my mind. And I say to you, beloved, that these things about spiritual formation, this is to get your attention. To awaken you from your decline. How do I know? The symptoms are there. You're not telling people about Jesus. When was the last time you actually opened your mouth and told somebody about Jesus Christ? Now, I'm not saying God is good. God is good. I know God is good. I'm not discounting that. But when was the last time you were able to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with somebody who's lost? When was the last time you felt emboldened by the Spirit of God to open your mouth and look at your neighbor, your friend, your cousin, and tell them, you know what, you're lost, you're on your way to hell? When was the last time you felt the inner impunct, the force of the Spirit of God, go tell them? And if you can't remember, you know what? Diagnostically, that's a sign. When was the last time you actually helped somebody to grow in Jesus Christ? God, everybody that he saves, he gives a gift so you can use your gift in the body to help somebody else grow. When was the last time you felt the inner urge to help, to come alongside somebody? Come alongside somebody and let me help you with that. Let me pray with you. Let me assist you. When was the last time you felt that? But you know what? The symptoms, the diagnostic symptoms of our condition here at Manna Bible are that we have a situation where I think we're in decline. Because instead of the body feeling like we should draw nigh, there is this sense that we need to go our own way, do it my way. I don't need that. See, what I'm saying is these are symptoms of decline, and it's designed. The idea, you know, in our discussion over these next few weeks, we're talking about adding to our faith. Look at 2 Peter. And here in 2 Peter, in fact, let me set a context. Now, how many of you have your Bibles? This is called Manna Bible, right? How many of you have your Bibles? God bless you for having your Bibles. And I hope and pray that it's not just you carrying your Bible. This is Manna Bible because we believe it, right? And what else? We read it, and what else? We do it. We do it. So that's the emphasis. It's hearing, it's reading, and it's the doing. Right? So it's Manna Bible. And I want you to know in this Bible, it's what Peter, what we're getting ready to read here is a letter. The Apostle Peter, the Apostle of Jesus, was led by the Spirit of God to write this letter to a number of saints. He sends this letter to this body of believers, this group of believers. Everybody didn't have a copy of Peter's letter. If you wanted to know what Peter said, you had to what? You had to come to church and hear when it was being read, what it was being read, because you didn't have it to take home. See, the context of the New Testament is that body life happens in community. They didn't have copies of Bibles. Now, it's fortunate that we have copies, but the sense of what God wants to do in the church is develop a community of hearers, a community of doers. And so Peter comes along, writes this letter, sends it to the people, and he says these words. Listen to this. Simon Peter, a bondservant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. He says, I'm a slave. I'm a slave to him. I'm writing to those who have obtained like precious faith with us. This is precious. This is precious. He writes to these precious saints who have precious faith along with other believers. In fact, Peter was a Jew. So I'm suggesting to you that this is, and he's intimating this idea of ethnic or racial unity to those who have obtained like precious faith with us. Who's the us? Jewish believers. Well, who's the other? Gentile. Look at this, that Gentile and Jewish believers can become one in a community of faith by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. He says to them, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. So much I want to say here, but I need to move on. But we're going to come back to this passage, but I want to show you this. He says, as his divine power, that is the Lord's divine power, has given to us. Do you, now, as we're reading through these, you're going to see these plural pronouns. Do you see them? Grace and peace be multiplied to you. You see that? Yeah. So the you is not what? It's not singular. It's what? It's plural. Peter writes to this group and he says, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus, who?
Our.
See, that's plural. There is the preciousness about our community, our faith that we share one with the Lord Jesus. Look at this, verse 3. As his divine power has given to all things. See, that's community. All things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called by glory and virtue. He called us by glory and virtue, by which has been given to exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. He wants us to, in fact, he notes that we have become, we, corporate body, have become partakers. We're fellowshipping in the divine nature. We have in the community of faith a fellowship in the divine nature. Isn't that amazing? That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, look at verse 5. But also for this reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith. What is he saying there? Expand your capacity. See that? It is absolutely wrong for any believer to say, I'm content. No. You can't. You can't be. If you're genuinely saved, you can't be. You won't be content. He says what? Add to your faith. And he talks about this idea of adding to our faith. So we're going to be talking about this over the next few weeks, this idea of expanding our capacity and adding to our faith. And one of the, when he's talking about the addition to our faith, it's the idea of adding virtue. Do you see this? So add to your faith. There are eight things here that he's talking about that are have levels of virtue and beauty that come from the divine nature. Look at this. What? Faith, virtue, knowledge, self, perseverance, godliness, brotherly love, and brotherly kindness and love. All of these things he wants us to add. He says what? Maybe I ought to read through it. Add to your faith virtue. To virtue, add knowledge. To knowledge, self-control. To self-control, add perseverance. To perseverance, add godliness. To godliness, add brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness, add love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful. Now there are a lot. What is barrenness as a believer? What is that? That's decline. That means we could possibly be in a place where we're not being productive. It's a waste. Jesus walked by a fig tree that wasn't productive. He came back and saw it again. It wasn't producing. He told them what? Cut it down. Why? Because it wasn't doing anything. It was taking up space and producing nothing. God forbid that any of us get there. And Linnea said, hope it's not too late. We can get to this place of barrenness and be content with where we are, where we think we are. But see, spiritual formation, your place in Christ, we're his children. We're his little toddlers. What does David know about what he needs to eat? What does a little toddler know about cooking food? What does he know? What does he know about putting on clothes? What does he know about how to go from one place to another? He knows nothing. But we get so haughty in our spiritual formation, we think we've got it. I got this, Lord. And all we are spiritual toddlers that are in desperate. See, this is a sign that we're in decline when we're not desperate for God. We're so self-sufficient. Do you know who I am? Do you know what I have? If these things abound in you, you're neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus. For he who lacks these things, look at this, is short-sighted. See, barrenness will lead to a sense of short-sightedness. You do not have 20/20 vision, even to blindness. See, people that are barren, that are not growing, see, they think they got it going on. And they're just as blind as a bat. They have forgotten that they were cleansed from their old sins. And look at what he says in verse 10. Therefore, brothers, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. Is it possible? Is it possible that you're barren because you never were saved? See, that's the implication there. He says, look, make sure that you are saved. Because if your barrenness and your lack of productivity continues, it is possible that you've never authentically and genuinely come to Jesus Christ. That's why you need to be desperate. That's why you really need to take a look at yourself. That's why you need to be in spiritual formation. If you don't sense the call of the Spirit of God to pray, it might be because you're barren. It might be because you're unproductive. It might be also because you're not saved. And this is, I hope and pray that this is perhaps stunning you the way Dr. Goldstein stunned me. I hope it's at least causing you to, at least to take pause, to take a second thought. Well, maybe. Look at verse 11. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to grow. And I'm convinced that a number of us here in Manna Bible want to grow. And so one point I want to leave with you going forward, and we're going to pick it up next week, but corporate prayer is part of the virtue, one of those virtues, one of those spiritual virtues that we need to add to our life. Now, I know you're praying at home, and God bless you for praying at home. But praying at home is not where you're growing. You will not grow at home. We grow in community. God designed it that way. How do I know that I can't and won't grow at home watching I wasn't thinking of Young and the Restless, no. But you know, we have a number of preachers on the television, and many believers unfortunately replace this corporate life for a TV life. And what one of the things you miss in that exchange is that you're not connected to a body, and there is no sense of accountability. Nobody can hold you accountable. That preacher on the television, on the radio, will not hold you accountable for your lifestyle. But in the community of faith, we hold one another accountable. And we'll pray for one another. Saints are giving money to radio, to television, and what? Now I know you'll get information. You'll get information, but what you won't get is this idea of community, of faith. this idea of community, or I'm sorry, corporate prayer is so essential to our growth because, and here's the first, and we'll pick it up next week, because, and it's demanded. I want to say it's demanded. It's not even an option. It's not even an option. Well, let me see. Should I pray at home or should I pray at church? Well, I think I'll pray at home. No, it's not even. Yeah, you need to pray at home, but it's not an option in terms of corporate prayer. Why? Because corporate prayer points to the nature of God. Amen. Yes, it does. Because what we have in God is Father, Son, Holy Spirit, who are united. They're diverse. They're plural. Three persons in unity. We have this Trinity where they share in the oneness of God. And so the church was created to point to this, the nature of God. And so in corporate prayer, we have all of the members of the body doing what? Becoming one, exercising unity. How? In prayer together, pointing to what? The divine nature, what? The Trinity, the triune nature of God. Corporate prayer models, it characterizes it, it illustrates, it points to the nature of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. They're gathered together. In fact, before there was a when, a where, or what, or how, when there was only Father, Son, Holy Spirit, there was this tremendous, intimate, deep devotion that they had for one another. And it got so good within the Trinity, God said, let us make man in our image. The intent is what? That man might enjoy the unity. And so corporate prayer really is, first and foremost, it's a picture of the divine nature. We have to pray together. Because the Spirit of God is calling us to do it. Now, so whether or not you will do it, that will be entirely up to you, beloved. But we're going to go forward. We're going to go forward, and this is one of the prayer items we have. We want to be praying about how to develop our prayer ministry here at Manna Bible. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the great privilege that we have to know you, to be in you.